One of the most important stages for set design in film, TV, and theater is actually the set dressing. And today we're going to be going through my essential tips, tricks, and things you need to know if you are set dressing for a show or for a film, and we are starting right now. What's up, you guys? Welcome back to my channel. My name is Jenny and I'm that props girl, and I am all about helping non-professional theatre makers, props designers, hobby crafters and decorators create unique props and decor. And as I said, today we are talking about the art of set dressing. Now, before we jump straight into that, I do want to say, if you did not check out my last video on the props department and all that that entails, we talked about the relationship between props and set and props and costumes, and we did a little bit of an intro into set dressing. So if you haven't seen that video, be sure to go and check that out and then pop back into this one when you've watched, because we are not going to be recapping what we discussed last week. If you guys enjoy this video, be sure to smash that like button, as it lets me know that you want to see more content just like this, as well as hit the subscribe button and bell so that you don't miss a single one of my uploads. And with all of that said and done, let's jump straight into this video. As we discussed last week, set dressing is extremely fun and it is such an essential part of making your set come to life. And this is not just for theater, this is for film and TV as well. If your set is meant to reflect real life, the set dressing is one of the most crucial elements to making this happen. And whilst it is extremely fun, it can also be a little bit difficult, especially if you are dressing a set that is from another era in time. If you're set dressing for a house that's in the 1950s, for example, you're not going to be filling it with furniture from today, because the TVs back then were black and white and also did not look like our flat screens today. And also the furniture was completely different. So if you do have a show like this that is set in another era in time, you're going to have to potentially do a little bit of research to figure out what exactly the furniture and the style was of that particular era. The 50s was a transitional era out of the war times and into a time of providence. The 50s was also a time where a lot of new technology was developed. And so if you're looking at a middle class to upper class family, they probably would have had a lot of the new technologies that were out there. And so, as I said, having a knowledge of history or doing some research is crucial to make sure that your set looks just right. Now, when it comes to filling your set and doing the set dressing, if you are looking at dressing a set for a different era in time, sourcing these items can be rather difficult if you don't know where to look. Ask around, first of all, see if anyone has any of these items that they'd be willing to donate, and let them know, if it is for theater, that there is a chance that they may not get it back. And some people don't like to lend things for that reason, and that's perfectly fine. But also look in thrift shops and op shops, because they tend to have a lot of things like that that are pretty cheap. Look online, you may find some things on eBay. I know I've purchased some vintage things on eBay for a pretty good price, and it's been really good quality, and obviously depending on where you get them from. And also, if you do have a bit more of a budget, you can look in vintage shops and antique shops. You just never know what you're going to find, but you do have to look. It is an exercise in sourcing, but the more you actually do it, the more you train your eye to look for things. But I can do a whole video on how to source props and actually how to develop a mental state of figuring out where to buy things from if you like. Let me know in the comments if you are interested in seeing a video like that. Set dressing for a specific character is also really, really fun. So if you're doing a house that has multiple people in it, you probably don't have the opportunity to personalize the set. But if you are doing, say, an apartment or a vehicle or a bedroom for a specific character, you can have a lot of fun with this. But the catch is that the space that your actor is in needs to reflect their character. And so you need to either speak to the director, the actor, or do some research into the character and understand what that character likes, dislikes, what's their mental state, what are they into, and what are their hobbies, and make sure that the set reflects that. So for example, in 2018, and I've discussed this many times before, I set dressed for a production of The Drowsy Chaperone. We set it in a very open plan kitchen in the 1980s, but the character for whose apartment it was, he's a theater enthusiast. He's also a bit of a kleptomaniac. And so the set really reflected this. Not only did it have to reflect his character, but it also had to be an 80s style kitchen. And so we had to fill it with things that would generally be in a kitchen, like plates and dish rack and fruit bowl and all those sorts of things still had to be in there as well, as long with books. And I had 4 meter high walls and I covered them all in theater posters and playbills and all that sort of stuff. And I just printed those off. But it's these sorts of details that you go into, because as I said in my previous video, when an audience is looking at that set, if the curtain is open, which it was on this show when the audience walked in, they got a sense of this is a person who lives in this house and they clearly really like theater. And you're actually adding to the character through the set, but you're also not taking away. So it's a hard balance between looking right and being a distraction. And as I said last week as well, if I've done my job properly, it shouldn't look like I've done my job at all, because it should actually just look right and it should be believable. One thing I did learn though from The Drowsy Chaperone is actually make sure that you over cater when you're either sourcing or purchasing things for your set dressing. Now, I know that this can sometimes be a bit more of a cost financially and you're not always able to do this, and I totally get that. If you do have the ability to do this, the reason why I say this is though, you may feel like you've got enough stuff. Quite often you don't. And that's something that I've learned over time. Last year, I set dressed for a production of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, the musical, and I absolutely loved this. When it came to set dressing the bus for that, I over-purchased, because sometimes you can think something will look right in your head, but when you put it on the set in with everything else, it doesn't quite work. And you don't want to put all your eggs in one basket. And set dressing the bus is a great example of how I had to combine both the look and feel of a drag queen bus that's traveled a really long distance, but also there were specific props that had to be on there, as well as ones that the actors could be playing with whilst the bus was traveling. So we had playing cards and magazines and things like that that they could occupy themselves with, and also making it look realistic. It had costumes, it had wigs, it had feather boas, it was fun, it had a stereo, it had magazines, it had a mirror ball, it had shoes, it needed to look lived in, because these three had traveled an awfully long distance. And anyone who's been on a long trip knows that whatever vehicle you're in may look pristine when you start, but by the time you get places, there are food wrappers and there are all these things in your car. This bus needed to look lived in. It needed to look like it was their space. If you're doing set dressing for a specific character, as I said, you need to get in the head, understand the story, understand the character that you are dressing for. And a really great example of this is actually The Big Bang Theory. And we're gonna do a bit of a case study now. Sheldon Cooper is a scientist. Now, he also likes things that are neat and tidy. He is very, very bright. He is extremely gifted. He loves collectibles. He loves comics. He loves all of those sorts of things. And his apartment reflects all of that. You see the periodic table from time to time. You see whiteboards with equations. You see books. You see laptops. You see collectibles. You see all of those references all around him. The apartment is also relatively clean and tidy as well, because that reflects how Sheldon likes his apartment to be. You also see that scientific model of, it looks like molecules and I'm not sure exactly what it is. And so you see all those sorts of things. Immediately the audience just accepts, oh, this is Sheldon's apartment, because the set dressing reflects who that character is and who they know him to be. That is then juxtaposed when you look at Penny's apartment, which is completely different, where there are bright colors and there are clothes and pillows and all these sorts of things strewn all over the place and magazines, and you see a totally different set because Penny and Sheldon are complete opposites. Penny is not pinned neat. She lives her life more carefree and she is so much more bubbly and out there, and her apartment reflects that sort of lifestyle that she lives. And so this is a great example, as I said, of how the set dressing affects the characterization, because the set is almost like a character in its own right, and you have to treat it like that when you're dressing it and understand what it needs to say about the person who lives in that set. Because you can't always have your character saying, oh, I like things neat and tidy. The set should just reflect that. And so that is why it is so important that your set dressing, along with the character's costume and the props and all this sort of stuff, works together to form a picture of who this character is. It's almost like a jigsaw puzzle. The pieces by themselves don't 100% make sense, but when you put them together, a picture comes together. That's all from me today. I hope that you learned something about set dressing and found this video interesting. Leave me a comment down below with your thoughts if you did, and smash that like button if you enjoyed this video. And consider hitting the subscribe button and bell so you don't miss any of my future videos. Stay tuned for my video next week because I'm going to be going through the whole preparation process and getting ready to put on a show, and the week before, bump in and all that sort of stuff, and all of my process to get myself ready to move into the theater. It may seem silly to go through that, but honestly, having done this for as long as I have actually mastered this sort of process, and it's now very streamlined, and these are all the things that I wish I had learned when I was just starting out. So stay tuned for that. I'll see you next time. Bye.